Good afternoon, doctors. On behalf of Zydus Nutriva, I welcome you to the webinar on new perspective in the management of recurrent UTI. Our speaker for today is Dr. Sanjay Pandey, consultant urologist and renal transplantation and head andrology and reconstructive urology from Kokilaben Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital, Mumbai. Dr. Pandey has many achievements to his credit. To mention a few, he is a member of Asia Pacific Board on Botox treatment in overactive bladder. He started the gender reassignment clinic at Kokilaben Ambani Hospital. Moreover, Dr. Pandey pioneered the all new multidisciplinary team of interstitial cystitis bladder pain syndrome at Kokilaben Ambani Hospital. Dr. Pandey was awarded the MUIC Fellowship of 2006 by Urology Society of India and Indo-Dutch Exchange Fellowship of 2001. Before I hand over this forum to Dr. Pandey, I take this opportunity to inform that today Zydus Nutriva has completed 8 years and we thank all the doctors for the support extended to our brands during these 8 amazing years. Also, I wish all Nutrivians a very happy Nutriva Day. Now I would request Dr. Pandey to take us through his presentation.
Thank you, Amruta. Good afternoon, everybody. I gather we have colleagues in general practice, physicians, gynecologists, and my colleague urologists in various parts of the country spending their afternoon with us and looking forward to a healthy discussion and creating a forum in recurrent urinary tract infection, something which a lot of our patients go through. And we as partners in this practice could probably make a change looking into what are the perspectives that we all combine together. Today happens to be a Nutriva Day, what I'm told, and I thank Zydus Nutriva have taken this kind of a approach to bring us all on a single platform to discuss a topic which is close to our heart. We attempt treating it by many ways, and some of the ways that we can't do on alone is where we probably combine and form a teamwork. So thank you all for having come on this pan-country board. We're talking on newer perspectives in management of recurrent urinary tract infection. Greetings from Kokilaben Dhirubhai Ambani Hospital, Mumbai, where I work as a consultant urologist. We follow a motto called every life matters. When we talk about every life matters, we look at every aspect of life that matters to a patient who actually comes to us or seeks support for us. We are extending ourselves today on the Nutriva Day to look forward to every quality of life matters. There are diseases of that quality of life issues which we are involved in. One of these quality of life issues which actually hampers a normal lifestyle of a patient in young age or old age could be a urinary tract infection. It being a one-off infection and being treated and cured completely would probably take the patient to next level. But if it is recurrent and continues to be recurrent and maybe beyond recurrence into urosepsis and phenomena which could put the patient at risk, it is important that we combine and do a great teamwork. So all that which we would like to discuss today with you and probably form a teamwork on this would be all about a recurrent urinary tract infection and take it forward step by step. I gather we have actually achieved a lot in urinary tract infection with a teamwork, with antimicrobials, with surgeries, with prophylaxis, and with a lot of cure that we're able to give patients to. But we still have miles to go. Whatever we have achieved and have come here right now, I think we need to still work hard and probably go there where we want to reach at some point in time. The endeavors that we take up in urinary tract infections are many. Few of them which I may have taken at some point in time as a perspective of a urologist could be neurosepsis in some challenging cases in UTI, and in many scenarios in which we have brought about a paradigm shift looking into various quality of life issues in UTI related to pregnancy and in young women. We emphasize that today in terms of putting forward an awareness drive to our colleagues in general practice and family physicians, to our colleagues in gynecology who happen to be partners in a lot of work in the pelvis with us. In a focus meet like today and many more focus meets across the country, we are able to experience the results of others and bring about a sharing of that, which finally we like to pass the benefit to patient and which we all do at our clinics at some point in time. We're looking at the topic of the day, recurrent urinary tract infection, which is defined as 3 episodes of UTI in the past 12 months or at least 2 episodes of UTI in past 6 months. In other words, it is just not one-off cure, but the patient goes through that agony of getting the symptoms back, and this is where we need to get into a picture and look at everything that we could do to prevent a recurrent UTI coming back again. So the clinical features, diagnostic testing, and the causative organisms are often similar to those of the single case of a UTI. There are additional treatment strategies and prevention mechanisms and measures which you need to consider today to prevent this from becoming recurrent and becoming it difficult for those women who undergo. Approximately 50 to 70% of women develop a UTI once during the lifetime, and 20 to 30% of them may have recurrence at some point in time. So this recurrent UTI could actually be a lot difficult to many patients, and that's what we need to look forward to. So there are some broad recommendations which colleagues in urological practice would put forward to all their colleagues who partner them in recurrent UTI, is that we need to exclude anatomic and functional abnormalities of the urogenital tract as a cause of recurrent UTIs in men and at least postmenopausal women. Now that is a group of patients who could have developing anatomic and functional abnormalities related to their age, related to changes happening with age in the genitourinary tract. Compared to that, in premenopausal or in younger women, a lot of which whom we see at various levels of practice, the yield of most diagnostic procedures for this indication is low. In other words, we may not be able to find many causes of recurrent UTI in that age group of women who possibly would then be looked at and look at various practices and prevention attitudes. You will believe me that recurrent UTI is a huge burden in the society, and patients do go to every clinician they know to and probably get their attempts to get treated. It's only after they have failed therapies or the disease becomes bigger than what it could be that they wake up and probably go to clinicians in different levels of practice. Therefore, the burden in the society has to be recognized and probably taken forward, and this burden is huge. Today we set a cross between you and us to connect the dots and pick up those important issues, possibly help these patients by various other modalities and methods and take them forward to treatment. We're looking forward to bacteriuria, and that is what a lot of patients are treated for. So bacteriuria, which could be symptomatic and giving a possible urinary tract infection, will have four responses during therapy. It could either be cured completely and it could be one of past history of a patient, or there could be bacteriological persistence, there could be a bacteriological relapse or a reinfection. It is important that you quantify a bit of it before we proceed to the slides. Relapse indicates that the infecting organism has persisted in the urinary tract despite a good clinical response during treatment. So it was good, but the infecting organism has persisted somewhere in the urinary tract. Reinfection is an infection after sanitation of the urine. And most of the urine, most of the time the bacterial species are actually probably different from what they have been cultured. So whether the recurrent UTIs are relapses or reinfections, and to make a differentiation between these patterns, because these are the ones which have got treatment consequences, are something which in long term is required for us to take it forward. The experts have the opinion that in persistent UTIs, the cause must always be evaluated. So if somebody has a persistent UTI, a recurrent UTI, a reinfection or relapse, it is important that we look forward to the causes and probably get forward in terms of being able to identify and treat. In a relapse UTI, the treatment can be given for a longer period of time, because just to prevent a relapse and take it to a logical conclusion. But if you look at men getting recurrent UTIs need to be looked forward with suspicion, because they could be people who could be having chronic prostatitis, they could be having bladder outflow obstruction in terms of either a metal stenosis, could have a stricture urethra, or possibly a prostate enlargement which could be occlusive, causing an occlusion and not able to empty, could be having a recurrent UTI. And finally, there could be a lot of complicating factors which could make a one-off UTI into a complicated UTI. So one needs to identify that if you have a complicating factors, bladder outflow obstruction and chronic prostatitis, many of these men could possibly land up getting infected. A larger picture of that today we are discussing is recurrence in women and recurrence overall. Well, look at that. One in four women develop recurrence after an episode of UTI, and there are umpteen factors which contribute or prevent it from happening. The factors that include our sexual intercourse, use of contraception, antimicrobials, the availability of local estrogen and estrogenic effects, some genetic factors, and the distance of the urethra from other locales like vagina and anus, which are actually storehouse of bacteria and could possibly cause infection when the bacteria move around and spread. So it's important that we actually take this in time, if not in time, land them bowling in life. They will try attempting treatment, various modalities will be tried. The strategies that we make for such patients will be lost in cascade. So it's extremely important that such patients get the best of their chance. When we look at that, we will have to help them out and take urinary tract into a different locale altogether, because these patients go through recurrence of infection. Not that the infection comes back with the same intensity every time. Some of times it could actually be much stronger and could go to the next level. Urinary tract therefore represents the most common site of bacterial infection in both hospital and community settings. Many of these recurrent UTIs do come to us, to our clinics, from various community settings. With increasing prevalence of now multi-drug resistance bacteria, urology as a specialty finds itself on the front line in the battle against the superbugs, and therefore I sit here with you to make this larger perspective of how to manage this. Therefore, I together combine and therefore make a stronger team to treat various aspects of recurrent UTI. If we don't do that, possibly we will land up doing this, because it could be a completely different ball game if there is absence of teamwork in any subject, including recurrent urinary tract infection. Let's move to an acute UTI scenario. An acute UTI scenario in a young woman could just be acute gross dysuria, burning sensation along the urethra and the introitus. There could be gross urgency, passing urine in drops because of the obstructive warning related to the mucosal edema, a pre-existing obstructive state which could have led to the infection perhaps. She could be in strangury, ineffective, painful warding with possible few drops of blood or hematuria. And at the end of it, it could possibly be a systemic phenomena where she could be lethargic. She may land up with fever and chills. So this could be an acute scenario which could be treated hard and fast if we get going with the treatment with antimicrobials, the immediate supportive therapies, give her the respite and probably come out of it. Imagine recurrence of these episodes, few per month, few per year, requiring sometimes oral antimicrobials to injectable treatments and supportive care, and who knows, sometimes going beyond that to a scenario of hospitalization, ICU care can be too much for a patient. That's why recurrent UTIs have to be nipped in the bud and we're set across to do something on that. Looking forward to acute uncomplicated cystitis. That happens only in patients who have got normal structure and function of the lower genitourinary tract. Essentially an febrile illness, 10% of women experience at least one episode of acute uncomplicated urinary tract infection at some point in time, even if mild in a year, and possibly 60% of at least these could have one more episode in their lifetime. So somewhere down the line, women may land up with a mild transient kind of an episode or an episode which may last few hours to few days. It's important that we prevent these acute uncomplicated cystitis to move forward and become a complicated UTI. Complicated UTI is an infection which is associated with a condition structure or a functional abnormality of the genitourinary tract, or the presence of underlying diseases that interferes with the host defense mechanisms, which increases the risk of acquiring infections or failing the therapy that we are taking to treat patients. They are not a straightforward UTIs like the patient presented in an acute scenario. This are a little different. Complicated UTIs are usually ascending. They have got a well-defined susceptible population. Drug resistance, unfortunately, is common. They have been on prolonged therapy outside before, possibly multiple times. And many times in immunosuppressed individual, it could be possible that it could be hematogenous and lymphatic spread. But that is a set of complicating factors which could make a UTI a complicated UTI. What are they? Indwelling catheters, obstruction to the flow of urine in antiquated fashion, which could be anywhere, an obstruction congenital or maybe an acquired. Male gender because of the complex genitourinary tract, which is with the accessory genital tracts. Age and age-related changes happening in the urinary passage, both in adults, male and men and women. Renal insufficiency, immunosuppressed states, diabetes mellitus, vesicoureteric reflux, which could sometimes be an infective reflux and could go and hit the kidneys. You could have urolithiasis, pregnancy, and warding dysfunctions of neurogenic kind. All of them actually happen to be complicating factors, which at some point in time complicate and don't let, in other words, get the UTI eradicated. So there is an anatomical and a structural abnormality predisposing these patients to a possible UTI, a UTI which cannot be treated directly with just medicines. They would require some surgical intervention. They could require some kind of a prophylactic therapy in patients with stents, possibly in patients with indwelling catheters. We go one step beyond a recurrent UTI to complicated UTI and look at a complicated UTI gone seriously wrong could unfortunately be a urosepsis. It amounts to at least 25% of sepsis of the entire body, and 35% of many ICU setups could actually be filled up with urosepsis of sad nature. It's often due to obstructive uropathy of the upper or the lower urinary tracts, and one needs to look into this. So what we're going to talk about is few scenarios in recurrent UTI before we go down to the basics about what are the new perspectives in the medical management and prevention of recurrent UTIs. I know each of you in this audience who has taken interest to come in a pan-country audience, treat urology in your own way. All of us go by evidence and experience that we have and what has been taught to us and what we train and polish in various workshops and by our teachers. All of us know that there are risk factors in both recurrent UTI as well as going into the cascade of urosepsis. The bottom line is gram negatives are the main culprits, the E. coli and its colleagues. It's important, therefore, we recognize everything quite early to prevent a catastrophe, or to prevent a catastrophe at least in the quality of life, if not a urosepsis mounting. Therefore, the next few scenarios are of recurrent UTIs in the institute where I work in, and the experience of our colleagues in various setups around. For example, look at a 46-year-old perimenopausal lady. She has been treated for recurrent UTI with acute episodes. An acute therapy has been instituted. The prophylactic therapy has later on been put forward. She has been on this kind of a management for some time. And then she gets another recurrent breakthrough UTI. If that is what she is going through, she is not in the best of her situation right now. She is young, she is in the most formative years and is going through that. And look at, her history is not about a post-coital phenomena. Therefore, she has attempted everything. She has attempted doctors, she has attempted everybody. She probably goes and sees a urologist. And the ultrasound looked okay to the urologist. He still decided to look at and take some history and understood that possibly a flow may be on the lower side compared to what she had a few years or a decade ago. See, he demands a uroflowmetry, which shows an obstructive flow pattern. So women with an obstructive flow pattern in a perimenopausal age group getting recurrent UTIs with acute episodes needs to be taken forward and logically concluded. He decides to do a micturating cystic urethrogram. And if you look at the left side of the frame, you can find a red arrow pointing to the urethra. Female has a distal urethral stricture. You can see probably 1.5 centimeter of or more of the distal urethra is looking like a small chink, which is all about a narrowing in the lower part of urethra. I mean, it can just be a part of the lichen sclerosus changes in a perimenopausal, postmenopausal age group. But this is the woman who has been treated medically for quite some time. So we made our attempts at any part of the country and probably giving a chance to this lady to treat medically. But there was something amiss. The recurrent UTI has a cause. And that's very classical in a young woman who is going through the agony of taking all attempts at treatments, doing the antimicrobials, injectables or orals, doing prophylaxis, maintaining the best of health and healthy hygienic practices, but goes to UTI and we pick up a female distal urethral stricture. There could be something in the past which has not been described in this case, but possibly she has a past history of trauma, instrumentation, traumatic catheterization, something which is amiss here, or it could just be a change of a BXO lichen changes which happen in perimenopausal change when the estrogens are going away and the hormone changes in the introitus pick up multiple changes around. So she is a case of female distal urethral stricture. Now all that a urology colleague would do is do a good urethrotomy, a urethral dilatation, watch her closely, put her on self-calibrations or call her for a supervised calibration. Look at in some way her uroflowmetry gets back to that peak which we look forward to. Her residual volumes go low. She maintains a hygienic practice being estrogen deprived in that age group and possibly would not be getting a recurrent UTI. So that is a scenario which we would look at. A young woman coming to us, all other factors in place, her urinary flow was not great and that was picked up by possibly a uroflowmetry. So this is one off case which I want to discuss on this. Let's go to a young male from a young woman. Recurrent UTI is the bottom line in him. He has got some dysuria, difficult to describe, some burning sensation. Now we describe his burning sensation is painful at the tip of the shaft. He has been treated conservatively outside very well and this is not very uncommon. That a lot of young men and women are not examined under the undergarments by many colleagues in various other disciplines of science because that's not their domain. A urologist and gynecologist would probably go inside and examine this young woman and young man. So when he lands up to a urologist and clinically finally examined, the story tells everything. He is a phimotic, he has a tight phimosis, there is an adhesive balanoposthitis, there is a firm indurated prepuce of years of whatever posthitis and inflammation, there is a smegma impacted. How do you expect this patient not to have heightened sensitivity at the tip of the penis? I mean, this is just one off case, but these are the young men who would require to be picked up earlier. So a young man should possibly be seeing his urologist early in the clinical scenario so as to when you stretch his penis and pull the prepuce back, you can hardly do it because the whole thing is quite indurated. It has been cleaned up well to show that there is a lot of induration, a lot of BXO changes. Matus looks good here, but that's a constant source of some kind of bugs being thrown around. All that he would require is a good cosmetic circumcision for enloplasty. He possibly will be able to maintain his hygiene by a self-hygiene of this body rather than attempting to do what he has to do every day right now. So a constant source of bugs sitting in that prepucial sac and the tip of the prepuce, everything covering around, he possibly would be in chronic balanoposthitis. So this is the patient who is a young man. Recurrent UTI has a cause. We are picking up a cause here. We should look at that. We are talking about a recurrent UTI in a young man. Let's just go a little deeper. This was a young man with urethral stricture. This was only picked up retrospectively. Recurrent UTI would not complain too much about his flow, but particularly adjusted to flow over. He had kind of coated which is picked up after intense history taking. Now, recurrent UTI was treated with antibiotics and supportive therapies as expected, but one fine day he lands up in an emergency and attempts at catheterization fails. Somebody attempts to do a urethrogram and see a long stricture in that penobulbar region. If that is what it is, it possibly is fixture which would require a corrective therapy because there are no dilators which would go in around. Either it would be a supervised endoscopic work or a good urethroplasty to keep him out of this recurrent UTI business. So imagine he from a recurrent UTI landed up in an emergency, and that's where somebody picks up that he actually has got an emergency created out of many years of a cold situation called a stricture urethra. So young men not passing urine well or young men coming with a recurrent UTI do have a cause. It could be at the meatus. It could be at the level of urethra. We would not suspect the prostate immediately because he is on the younger side and prostate may not be occlusive. But there are occlusive areas which can occlude, and every young man worth his salt who gets recurrent UTIs, lands up with possible cysts, has to be evaluated much earlier than this emergency. There was this young lady who underwent transplant 15 years ago. The transplant kidney did well for less than a decade and thereafter unfortunately got rejected. She continued to live with the rejected. He went back to dialysis and continued to do well in whatever quality of life she landed up again. The issue was she landed up with a recurrent UTI, being in that perimenopausal, postmenopausal age group by now. She was treated very well. The lower tract was evaluated and she was treated with antimicrobials and supportive therapy. Every time she would get a UTI, she would get all kinds of systemic symptoms and would not be able to manage herself. Remember, she was a CKD. When you do a CT scan of this patient, you can look at the arrow pointing on the left side is that transplant kidney lying in the pelvis. This transplant kidney is rejected. It's a chronic pyelonephritic kidney, a small shrunken. There's no differentiation of the entire kidney. You don't see the calyces. You don't see hollow structures here. What do you see? A lot of calcification. So the kidney is all ridden with calcification as an atrophic kidney lying there with loss of whatever corticomolar differentiation, rejected, pyelonephritic and sitting there. And what is it busy doing? Throwing bugs all the way down into the urinary tract. So this immunosuppressed patient gets this recurrent UTI. All that was required was a good nephrectomy of a transplant kidney to bring her out of this unfortunate event of recurrent UTI. She's back on dialysis and possibly would get a next transplant at some point in time. So we sometimes treat this residual hydroureternephrosis as residual and think forward to that. These may not be big issues around. These patients who had recurrent UTIs and some urosepsis land up with nephrectomies and look at their kidney specimens. These are specimens of patients who had actually now residual hydroureternephrosis, cavitary kidneys, cavitations with debris and bugs. And this would always throw bugs down and we would land up treating the end result, the urinary system. But what we have is to get rid of somewhere situations which actually are causing recurrent urinary tract infection. Okay, let's go to something else. A recurrent urinary tract infection gone completely wrong. 52-year-old female, uncontrolled diabetes, recurrent urinary tract infection, presents now from a milder state that she has been few times a year with fever and chills and right flank pain. That is sad. Now ultrasound on a CT scan show right hydroureternephrosis. That means there's a swelling in the kidney and the ureter, but they don't pick up anything like a stone. There's obviously some occlusion. Remember, she is an uncontrolled diabetic. And uncontrolled diabetes and urinary tract have a love-hate relationship. She is a case of a papillary necrosis in an acute setup where a ascending UTI gone to the kidney cause an acute pyelonephritis. It could have landed up even with an emphysematous pyelonephritis. Who knows? But there was a papillary necrosis and a papilla like a prawn comes down, drops down somewhere, blocks any part of the ureter, the narrow aspects in the lower part. Therefore, she was managed with specific antibiotics and a ureteroscopy was done in an emergency setup more to put up a stent. A papilla extraction happened because the telescope could go in and a stent was placed. Recurrent UTI practices put in place immediately thereafter could be more of help rather than leaving her alone. So if you look at this picture, she is a case who is undergoing papilla extraction and then we put a stent across. Now, this was a 48 hours history of dysuria, pain, fever, right flank pain. She was managed conservatively immediately. Her progression happened very quickly and she worsened. When she presented, she was in sepsis and shock. She required supportive therapy for sepsis, golden hour treatment of injectable carbapenems. These are all to take her from a situation that she had landed herself on. She was on recurrent UTI prophylaxis for long. The patch was extracted and a stent was placed. I'm just showing you the last part to give you an idea as to what can recurrent UTI even go through. The stent is inside the ureter and you can see the kind of pus that comes out in such patients around. So a urinary tract of a compromised patient which has been blocked by a stone which has fallen down the ureter or a papilla which has necrosed out here and fallen down in uncontrolled diabetes, acute severe pyelonephritis, progressing to something more severe where the papilla being at farthest from the blood supply can actually necrose and fall off, could lead to this kind of a situation where she lands in a life-threatening situation. So recurrent UTI always has a cause. She had recurrent UTI, her diabetes was uncontrolled, other things were possibly good, and she landed up with this situation where you are seeing toothpaste kind of pus being drained at a midnight hour, where we need to do it at the point in time that she arrives. She is not the best of her situation for anesthesia, and our anesthetists are strong enough to be able to take such daunting cases at midnight hour in the shortest time that they prepare. The intensivists worked very hard to get these cases of sepsis move forward to the operation theater. Relatives do understand the kind of nuances we go through as urologists in the whole country. So we look forward to recurrent UTI be taken to a next level where we prevent it from happening. So that's a stent in situ. Diabetes and urology always have a love-hate relationship. It's important that we know that they are very closely related. Diabetic cystopathy or the loss of bladder sensations in the mucosa and loss of bladder contractions at the motor level or the detrusor level makes this diabetic bladders weak both in sensations and contractions. They could be lazy bladders not emptying completely. Many of these long-standing diabetics may not know that the bladder has weakened up, has got lesser sensations. They don't pass urine like you and me multiple times a day, but probably once in a day and once at night. And they are the patients who possibly have diabetic cystopathy, an entity which has not been described and taken care of much in today's world. Recurrent UTIs are not uncommon in diabetics, partly because, again, an immunosuppressed state, partly because of changes happening in the urinary system. One of them is diabetic cystopathy, where there's a large amount of urine left over as a residual. Even after, there may not be a much outflow obstruction because of prostate or urethra or meatus. Recurrent pyelonephritis as recurrent UTIs, unfortunately leading to CKD because of the mechanism of damage which is happening, one of the common indicators of a CKD being long-standing diabetes. You saw a picture of diabetic papillary necrosis. Unfortunately, a lot of young men go through diabetic microangiopathy and at that level, erectile dysfunction. So, somewhere, we need to have cautions in UTI, in complicated UTI and in urosepsis, where we know that adjustments to urinary tract is quite common in immunosuppressed states. A classical example is diabetic cystopathy in elderly diabetics, diabetics with long-standing diabetes, uncontrolled, partly controlled. Somehow they manage their diabetes to some levels around there. End organ changes happening in the retina, in the eyes, in kidneys as end-stage renal disease, and in the bladder as cystopathy. It's important that we look at all patients because they are changing very gradually to urinary tract and look at their immunosuppressed status being in the best of correction. The messages always are don't treat our dysuria very empirically. Dysuria or burning sensation and dysfunctional kind of state in the lower urinary tract always to be treated at the onset ASAP. Give relief because it's more of a symptom, not a disease. Symptomatic treatment to get the patient, get back to you, get the treatment of the larger symptoms and the larger curative therapies on the same time. All documented UTIs, whichever, should be taken to quite a culture negative status if possible. Recurrent UTIs always have a cause. Obstruction is a common mechanism I'm showing you here. Proper choice of antibiotics, progressive escalation and de-escalation is almost a rule in such situations. Therefore, recurrent UTI regimens of prophylaxis and close follow-up will be a lot to discuss today, because that is what we look forward to in many patients, and many of my colleagues in general practice, physicians, gynecologists will take up that challenge and take it forward. We'll look forward and see a 55 years old male, again a recurrent UTI. He's 55, he's young. He has got a grade 1 prostatomegaly. If that is what it is, not many people would have been bothered about his prostate because it's a 25 gram small prostate. He has got moderate progressive obstructive warning. He doesn't confess to his too much unless he goes to his urologist. The pathway is he has been on some medical management. He has failed all medical management, both for the prostatism which he is going through and obviously the recurrent UTI that he has landed up. His ultrasound shows bladder internal echoes and not a great news at all. If he lands up with fever, then we know that we have met our match. And in a situation like this, it's possible that we look at just under general anesthesia is attempting a cystoscopy to look at this bladder echo, look at the prostate. We have been told that this prostate is very small. Under general anesthesia, we find it very difficult to enter this prostate. So it's not the size of the prostate alone, externally measured on the ultrasound. It is the internal occlusion which is brought about by the occlusion of the urethra, by the prostate that seemingly grows inside. Look at that. The urologist struggles here under general anesthesia to take the scope inside because it's an occlusive prostate. He looks at it, doesn't want to traumatize through his 20 sheath, and then he comes back and looks at, is there something wrong? Am I not able to enter the prostate? He then makes an angle change and with some difficulty with that lobe, the median lobe penetrating there, he enters and lo and behold, he has entered a place which has all got debris, dirt, muck, pus, whatever you say. That bladder is containing a lot of debris out here. This gentleman has got bladder echoes which is visible to you right now live as you enter the bladder. He has got fever. So this systemic phenomena of getting fever from a localized obstruction is not uncommon. If he is a diabetic, he could land up in a bigger trouble of possibly a urosepsis. All that it could require is a whatever a small prostate, a good PURP, creating a good channel for him to pass urine well. His obstructive warding disappears. He is not into any more of that. And therefore, his recurrence of UTI will disappear and his medical therapy too. These kind of patients are not uncommon. Now imagine a recurrent UTI in a little bit elderly patient. He is 55, somebody maybe possibly 65. Again, a recurrent UTI. May have a prostatomy galli, and therefore we blame everything to a prostate. If this man is topped up with diabetes, which is uncontrolled, which I was just talking, we may land up in trouble. So 65 years old diabetic, recurrent UTI and medical treatment, and obviously well managed for quite some time, has sudden onset retention, sepsis, dysuria, and undergoes catheterization. He is in sepsis. So there's something more amiss than whatever was happening before. All this while, he was a recurrent UTI. And when we look at that, we are looking forward to cystoscopy. And this is an enlarged prostate. We have done an ultrasound before we got in. And the ultrasound picture is what makes us get into an emergency situation in this. So from what we had, we have a situation now where we will possibly find pus pouring out from the TURP. So you can see what is coming happening right now is pus pouring out as a TURP is done in an emergency setup, which is basically to deroof the prostatic abscess. So this prostatic abscess has resulted from recurrent UTI in a compromised individual who has got a lower tract obstruction resulting from his prostatomegaly, and the obstruction which has been caused because of the occlusion of prostate, topped up with occlusion, diabetes, and look at his prostate, which is a solid organ, not infected. And infection has lost its battle, and you can see pus being actually now, you know, removed by some kind of a deroofing of the abscess that has happened around. So it's not uncommon that we would see such situations in, unfortunately, recurrent UTI scenario. So one needs to look into these patients around. So one has an elderly diabetic man who is has got all these comorbidities. He also has got prostatomegaly. He sees my colleagues in general practice and sees my colleagues in urologists. And we know that when we need to act and act fast is in such situations where we do some non-invasive investigations like a uroflowmetry, pick up early obstruction of a kind which is refractory to medical management, and treat him. So a refractory recurrent UTI possibly has a cause of that kind where we are able to manage and treat such patients earlier rather than they land up with a urosepsis of this kind. So the suggestions here would be, we look forward to these patients seeing their urology doctors faster and probably escape possibility of that kind of a situation. So this is what something which we need to look into. So recurrent UTI has a different kind of a pathophysiology, because the main causative agent involved in recurrent UTI in women is E. coli, which is responsible for approximately 80% of all episodes of infection. The other significant pathogens in recurrent UTI which has been actually colonized and looked at in various RCTs are Staphylococcus saprophyticus, Klebsiella pneumoniae, and Proteus mirabilis. Now, if you look at Klebsiella and Streptococcus infections are relatively more common in diabetic patients who are getting recurrent UTI. If you have seen Pseudomonas infections, they are relatively more common in patients with chronic catheterization, chronic foreign bodies like stents and probably stones sitting somewhere in the urinary tract. Proteus mirabilis is common uropathogen in patients with indwelling catheters, spinal cord injuries, structural abnormalities of urinary tract. These are more epidemiological studies rather than incriminating that a bacteria could be related to that kind of a pathology, but more commonly to one than to other. A number of host factors appear to predispose otherwise healthy young individuals, mainly women, to recurrent UTIs. And these happen to be the local pH and the cervicovaginal antibody changes which happen in the introitus and the vagina, greater adherence of the uropathogenic bacteria to the uroepithelium, and pelvic anatomic differences which happen in women, which is anatomical compared to men, where there's a shorter urethra, maybe the tip of the urethra or the distal urethra could be colonized by bacteria, and a shorter distance between the urethra to the anus, shorter distance between the urethra to the vagina. Remember, vagina and the anus could be storehouse of various kinds of bacteria waiting and lurking out there to infect a pristine tract called the urinary tract. Postmenopausal women have got different kind of changes happening around, like the men having prostatomegaly enlargement. Women have estrogen loss at menopause resulting in thinning of the vaginal epithelium and therefore decreased amount of glycogen and a fighting capacity. The resulting environment is hostile to lactobacilli, and therefore the number of lactobacilli decreased, which actually were preventive of the vaginal infections around. And as a result of which, the vaginal pH increases, and there is an increased propensity of colonization with various kinds of pathogens, which could even be uropathogens. All women with recurrent UTI should undergo a physical examination, which all our cases are examined by our colleague gynecologist in the building, to evaluate urogenital anatomy and estrogenization of vaginal tissues to detect prolapse and to look at the entire introitus area. Post-war residual urine is such an important measurement. It gives us an idea as to how much are you holding in the backdrop of this change of obstruction, change of epithelialization, all of which could be predisposing women to UTI. Diabetes screening is indicated in patients with other risk factors such as family history, obesity. So looking at a postmenopausal woman, a perimenopausal woman with these kind of changes, which is expected to happen perhaps, most women do not require a very extensive urological investigation. So therefore, many of my colleagues in gynecological practice across the country do a wonderful service in looking at recurrent UTIs, treating them, doing a teamwork with the urology colleagues and looking forward to these recurrent UTIs being abolished. However, women who suffer from infection with organisms that are not common causes of urinary tract infection like Proteus, Pseudomonas, Enterobacter and Klebsiella may have structural abnormalities or renal calculi. Now, these are the women who probably would benefit from various studies, possibly a cystoscopic look inside and other investigations which could be rendered as extensive urological requirements because they don't fit into a straight case. Women who have got persistent hematuria after resolution of the infection also require a complete urological workup for multiple reasons. Although empiric therapy based on symptoms is generally accurate and cost effective, women who are felt to be in early stages of this problem, recurrent UTI, should have documented cultures to be proven that they are negative or they have been taken to the logical conclusion of clearance or cure of this UTI. Urine culture therefore not only serves as a gold standard for diagnosing with accuracy these issues, but also provides a specificity of the uropathogen and the antibiotic susceptibilities, which we fall back upon. The standard definition is that 10 to the power 5 colony forming units per hypophene is what you fall back upon in patients around. Now let's look at the one aspect which we probably forget as clinicians back in our clinics, is that we don't tell patients about how to give a sample. It's so important that all these women are not like men, their urinary samples may not be easy to collect and they would possibly be taking the first sample which comes out of the body rather than a midstream clean catch specimen. So all our colleagues in general practice in gynecology and colleagues who would practice a urological aspect to their domain would request the patients to be giving a urinary specimen in full bladder where they start passing urine. The first part of the urine goes to the washroom and as the middle part of the stream is coming out, that means the midstream specimen is coming out of the body under very controlled clean conditions. The clean catch specimen is collected in that sterile bottle given to you, capped without touching and contaminating, and left at that point of time for it to be cultured. So these are little important aspects which I think we all should get involved to make the agony of these patients less, because there are times we are actually a lot governed by the culture reports and looking at the patient and the culture. It should not be there's not a proper concurrence between the patient. A patient may be completely normal, looking like you and me across the table, and may have a culture report 10 to the power 5 and may have no symptoms, may not agree to a therapy or not agree to an extensive urological workup. So quite an important scenario right now to look at how they collect the samples and how do we counsel them. The counseling across the table is a very, very important aspect of these patients around. Okay. Now if you look at a urinary sample which you have told a patient to do and look at more than 20 epithelial cells per hypophile on urine analysis, it suggests that there has been a contamination. There has been a mixed bag, possibly a lot of vaginal secretions. And this probably could be a contamination. The bacteria may still grow and give you some kind of a 10 to the power 4, 10 to the power 5 confusion. Because bacteria reduce the urinary nitrates to nitrites, the use of urine dipstick analysis can be extremely helpful. A positive result usually indicates infection with the specificity and sensitivity of a variable kind. A negative result does not rule out infection if the patient is symptomatic. So a dipstick is not the final and the last test in these kind of evaluations, because some bacteria like Staphylococcus saprophyticus lacks the enzymes to actually reduce nitrates to nitrites. So saprophyticus is also one of those lurking issues in recurrent UTI in a normal woman too. So if urine has not been present in the bladder for at least 4 hours, there may not be enough sufficient time for the reaction to occur, and there's a possibility of leukocyte esterase being produced by neutrophils indicating pyuria, which is associated with UTI, may be missed out in some of these patients around. So we're looking today that we have found cases which were of recurrent UTI as scenarios in UTI. We looked at UTI can actually move forward from a possible UTI to not getting treated, getting relapse and reinfection because they have complicating factors and a complicated UTI. If not taken to logical conclusion by possible surgeries or possible interventions or possibly clearing those complicating factors of stones or stents or catheters or prostates, we could land up in the possible urosepsis. So we will, as colleagues in various aspects practicing urology, work towards as a team to look forward to prevent these patients from going to anything higher than what they suffer from. Now that they're suffering from recurrent UTIs, we got to look forward to this subject and the new perspectives that we are armed with today in urological practice, which help us and our patients to be effectively fighting these situations that we go through. For example, Antibiotic prophylaxis is the mainstay of therapy in prevention of recurrent UTIs, a very, very important aspect. It is important especially because it prevents the recurrent UTI in that class of patients who are premenopausal young women who for multiple risk factors or no risk factors could be getting UTIs and you may not be able to pinpoint a cause by any diagnostic evaluation. These women need to undergo some kind of a prophylaxis. The Cochrane review did a lot of work on that, and the reviews that we did work up before we came for this presentation talks about various kinds of prophylaxis regimens which are taken care of. For example, some women get a post-coital prophylaxis, some women get a weekly prophylaxis, some people continue prophylaxis for months, and some probably will have a very low dose prophylaxis at night. So there are various kinds of prophylaxis which have been studied. All of them actually are tailored to different kinds of requirement. Some patients may only require a post-coital prophylaxis, that's all. Some patients who are at risk because of the kind of introitus makeup, the kind of urethral meatus which possibly opens close to the vagina or maybe a hypospadiac meatus may require prophylaxis all their life or possibly changing the meatal site from the vaginal hypospadiac region to the introitus or external region. Some of the women who possibly get UTIs because of the perimenopausal age group and you undergo dilatation, calibrations, cystoscopies may require longer calibrations. Some of the sexually active women who probably require a longer kind of a prophylaxis. So looking at that, continuous prophylaxis for 6 to 12 months is not unknown. It reduces the rate of UTIs during the prophylaxis period and don't get a breakthrough. So you don't go through the agony of getting back to the therapeutic antibiotics. Who knows, you may require injectable antibiotics for a therapy. Prophylactic antibiotic selection, therefore, this should be made on the basis of a lot of things, a lot of strategies which every institute and the board and the infection control team happens to be looking at, which they look into community resistance patterns, the community acquired infections, the side effects of the drugs which need to be given for a longer period of time, albeit they are being given at a smaller dose or a prophylactic doses, and the kind of cost containment and the balancing with the disease process. Somewhere this has to be looked into. When we look at the larger aspect of duration of prophylaxis, it should be guided by the severity of the patient's symptoms and by the physician-patient preference. So that's where a great communication across the table, looking at the changes happening, and SOS request is what will help us in deciding the duration of prophylaxis for many of these patients. 6 months of treatment followed by observation for reinfection after discontinuing prophylaxis has been empirically recommended by the Cochrane reviews, but not necessarily 6 months for everybody. We sometimes go and change antibiotics, sometimes put on the lower doses, sometimes the nightly doses, sometimes support it with other symptomatic therapies around. Some authorities have recommended longer courses in 2 to 5 years in patients who continue to have recurrent infections without a cause. So all this time we were talking about recurrent UTI has a cause, and a urologist would suit to be in that panel or in that team to quickly take away that cause. But the possibility many a times there may be no causes and we are lost. The files get thicker, patients keep changing cities and clinicians, and probably would require only one thing: supportive symptomatic treatment, supportive treatment to prevent symptoms, and that probably could require a longer prophylaxis, and they're very, very safe. Postcoital prophylaxis may be preferable for women with UTIs completely or temporarily related to the intercourse alone. No marked differences in recurrent UTIs has been noted when using postcoital prophylaxis compared to the daily prophylaxis. Depending on frequency of sexual intercourse, postcoital prophylaxis usually results in a lesser antibiotic use. So you will not be landing up with an acute dysuria strangury setup, and therefore you will escape a possibility. Now while we do the antibiotic prophylaxis, there are various supportive therapies which are required. We're looking at women getting more commonly recurrent UTI without an obstruction. And estrogen use in postmenopausal women has actually been already studied in RCTs. The Cochrane review talks a lot about it. Evidence from 2 small RCTs show that in postmenopausal women, the recurrent UTI, vaginal estrogens reduce the number of UTIs, and that's well documented. So estriol cream vaginally every night, or clinicians practice alternate night for 2 to 4 weeks, and thereafter could be twice weekly for the next few months, could significantly be a supportive kind of a regimen which could help many of these women escape a possibility of a flare-up. Now the mechanism of these estrogens working is all about possibly reappearance of the vaginal lactobacilli, which decreases the vaginal pH. Lactobacilli prevent overgrowth and colonization of the enterobacteriaceae in the vagina, thus reducing the occurrence of UTIs, which actually was happening or has been happening around. So estrogen has a role. It has been proven that we supplement a bit of estrogen on a nightly kind of a cream, it takes a lot of care of it. So looking at various supportive therapies, and that's where our perspectives are gradually changing. We looked at cranberry over the last n number of years. We looked at they have been touted as effective home remedies, and we gather in the Western world, women used to carry it in their purse and probably keep popping in as and when required, like chocolates, looking at an anti-infective regimen of it. But I think we have moved forward from that and probably given it a role of a nutraceutical, role of a supportive therapy, something which is a part and parcel of therapy in such women. Cranberries contain two kinds of compounds which have anti-adherence properties that actually prevent this fimbriated E. coli, the commonest culprit, from adhering to the uroepithelial cells in the urinary tract. Remember, the urinary tract in that woman is the only place where there are no bacteria. Just behind that, the vagina is full of bacteria, and behind that, anus is all full of bacteria. So you have got your friendly neighbors full of bacteria, and you have got this house where there are no thieves. You need anti-adherence mechanisms, because if a thief comes in, he possibly will not be able to adhere. And cranberries actually have got these two compounds which help us out. So there have been very various clinical trials which have been looked at the effectiveness of cranberries and cranberries with other supplements too. So when you look at that, we look forward to various roles of cranberries and various kinds of anatomical changes that they bring about to such patients around. The important property of E. coli is its adherence to the host tissues because of the adhesin protein called the pili or the fimbriae. So either the pili or the fimbriae are which adhere, and once they adhere, they start colonizing, moving up the ladder and changing their colony counts very quickly. Cranberries work principally by preventing the adhesion of type 1 and the P. fimbriae strains, particularly from the E. coli, to the urothelium. So you are not letting the bacteria adhere. The bacteria comes into the room, surveys, and possibly goes away, because the adhesion mechanisms are being prohibited by two kinds of mechanisms which cranberry could do. Without adhesion, the bacteria cannot infect the mucosal surface. It will be only a party of probably coming in and going away. So what are the mechanisms we look forward to? The two components of cranberries, basically the fructose and the PSE, help in preventing adherence of the type 1 fimbriae and the P. fimbriae. And if that is what happens around, cranberry compounds act as receptor analogs, competitively inhibiting the adhesion of E. coli to the host cells by binding to the fimbrial tips. That's a great mechanism. I'm glad we could find it n number of years ago. And I think in due course of time, this has been probably one of the mainstays of therapies while antibiotic prophylaxis is on. So that's how it is. The E. coli, somehow with anti-adhesion mechanisms, is not able to somewhere attach onto any location, because it's already the receptor analog activity is acting around. It has to probably be a friendly tourist in the bladder urinary tract and probably has to disappear or washed off if there's no obstruction to the urinary tract. Therefore, another mechanism of cranberry activity is reduction in the expression of P. fimbriae in the E. coli by changing the conformation of surface molecules. So why the bacteria is inside the urinary tract and cranberry is replete, and probably looking at the environment of the urine, it can decrease the virulence of E. coli by reducing the expression of this P. fimbriae, which actually therefore is brought about by changing fimbrial length and fimbrial density. So the E. coli is being rendered ineffective by more than one way by cranberry alone inside the urinary tract. I just looked at the various clinical trials and I was impressed with the kind of work which has been done, which is now right now in the domain which all of us need to look into and understand that cranberries have a role. They have a role possibly in this non-obstructive tracts where the bacteria is rendered ineffective by the fimbriae channel, by the channel of fimbrial length and defense mechanisms going down as a result of the new mechanisms which have been actually proposed. So the recent clinical trial which actually was presented at the pilot study in 2015 talked about cranberry supplementation in prevention of non-severe lower tract infection. And that's what we're looking at, ladies and gentlemen. Non-severe lower tract infection should not worsen. So recurrent low-grade UTIs which women go through few episodes per month per year should not worsen to require injectable antibiotics or land up with urosepsis. I think it's important that our colleagues in other practices, including family practice, general practice, colleagues in gynecology across the country, take this challenge of preventing recurrent UTI by all those mechanisms that they already do. We're just trying to probably bolster the needs of these. So non-antibiotic prophylaxis of recurrent UTI infection, a systemic review and meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials was actually presented in our Guru Granth Sahib called the Journal of Urology last year, which goes on to make us more and more robust about the possibility of looking at this nutraceutical as a very important add-on mechanism. While we talk about cranberries over the last 4 or 5 years, I think, we're looking at another molecule which has been equally effective and probably combinations have worked. D-mannose is a sugar that has an important role in human metabolism, especially in glycosylation of certain proteins. Now, D-mannose is widely available and used for UTI prevention in human as a food supplement. Its therapeutic effect was not known till there were trials which were published in the Journal of Urology last year. The anti-adhesive effect of D-mannose has been clearly established now, ladies and gentlemen, something which we need to look into in a larger way. So D-mannose binds and blocks the FIMH adhesin, which is positioned at the tip of the type 1 fimbriae of the enteric bacteria. We talked about type 1 fimbriae and the P. fimbriae, the two kinds of fimbriae we could attach and give the foothold on the uroepithelium layer. Now this one, D-mannose binds at the and blocks the FIMH adhesin, which is lying at the tip of the type 1 fimbriae. Therefore, during bacterial colonization, FIMH binds to the carbohydrate containing glycoprotein receptors on the epithelium of the urinary tract. And this binding leads to bacterial adhesion, less clearance of bacteria, leading to recurrent UTI. So that's a mechanism. Probably a recurrent UTI is still on even after we have effectively or non-effectively done a part of our work with cranberry. If that is so, D-mannose acts as a competitive inhibitor of bacterial adherence because it's seated right at the tip of the FIMH adhesin molecule. Now, insufficient concentration in urine D-mannose causes saturation of FIMH adhesins and prevents the bacteria from binding to urothelial receptor. So it's going one step further beyond cranberry. This is something which is impressive. The mannose containing side chains of the protein bind bacteria and facilitate their elimination with reduction of the various bacterial levels which could be happening. Look at the pictorial diagram of it. The FIMH, the type 1 fimbria on your right, and you look at the D-mannose acting there and not letting that FIMH adhesin attach to the uroepithelium. And some way, that kind of a methylation of the glycoproteins prevents in changing the receptor activity and not letting the bacteria adhere. So there is an additional mechanism which we look forward to right now when we use D-mannose in terms of empowering ourselves and our patients from preventing a UTI to become recurrent. So World Journal of Urology in 2014 came up with this very important original article which actually been cited for 20 more articles around. The D-mannose powder for prophylaxis of recurrent UTI infections in women. The RCT was quite a strong RCT. Looking at this picture, I probably go on to say that if a combination of these two therapies from East and West, maybe cranberry and D-mannose, would be a great therapy for a lot of patients. And I'm sure we are slower than the promoters of these kind of molecules in our country. So it's visible to us that the dosages are very important. The dosages are prophylaxis, dosages are treatment. We're looking forward to preventing UTIs in women. We're looking forward to antibiotic prophylaxis. We're looking forward to estrogenization of this perimenopausal, postmenopausal enteritis. We look forward to various nutraceuticals which directly work against the bacteria in the environment. We look at the environment where the bacteria is sort of paralyzed, its fimbrial length and its adhesion molecule capacities decrease, and there is working in D-mannose at a proper dosage around. I gather the article talks about 2 grams of D-mannose as an important element reaching the urinary tract. So maybe cranberry plus D-mannose coming as sachets, coming as tablets, coming as various forms in the country could actually be a good nutraceutical helping these patients around, and patients do accept it. When you say an antibiotic for 6 months, they possibly will not accept it. But when they get recurrent UTI and you use a low dose antibiotic prophylaxis, they don't get breakthrough infection, they're fine with it. There's another angle which you could add and which we all add now in the country who deal and treat recurrent UTIs is possibly add this combination of cranberry with D-mannose in the proper dosage of 2 grams of D-mannose every day. I think it works well. So to me, I think we add 1 gram D-mannose in the morning and 1 gram D-mannose in the evening as a tablet or a sachet form. So whichever we do, we need to look forward to UTI versus the quality of life. The quality of life of every patient matters. These are formative years of young men, women who actually are busy in the lifestyles in the cities and countries. It's important we look forward to recurrent UTI not worsening the quality of life. It could worsen the quality of life in the bed, in office, in travel, in work, and therefore lower productivity from each of them. A recurrent UTI should not go to a complicated UTI and therefore finally should be treated. It's all about we combining together and making it a treatable phenomena. It's no more a taboo. Recurrent UTI doesn't make thick files anymore in the cities and country. We all need to have a basic evaluation. I think all of us spend a lot of time with patients discussing their complaints, looking at some supportive evaluations. We identify the risk factors and complicating factors of these patients around. We will look forward to cure and cure in every patient. But those who are prone to possible recurrent UTIs would require a prophylaxis, maybe for a longer period of time, getting the confidence that they are in a better shape. We later on escalate and de-escalate as required, possibly preventing breakthroughs. Long-lasting measures are therefore placed into importance. And we follow up these patients, we don't forget them. They are the patients who need to be treated. The future of recurrent UTI is good. We see lesser and lesser of recurrent UTIs coming to the OPD. I just wish less and less recurrent UTIs have a flare-up for multiple hostile and host factors which could land them into urosepsis, and for which effective therapy is happening in various institutes, colleges, clinicians, hospitals, nursing homes around. All that we need to look at the future in many ways apart from the effective agents we did discuss. The newer perspectives would again be spreading an awareness to the society, awareness to our colleagues in practice who see a lot of it. We as urologists in India and in various countries only see tip of the iceberg of recurrent UTIs or urosepsis. Our colleagues in gynecologists see more because all women land up with them and they are actually the pile drivers, or they are the drivers of this subject. They would look at more and more such patients getting treated and preventing a recurrent UTI. If there is one, I'm sure a gynecologist involves her urology colleagues and takes it to the highest possible level. I have not talked about this important aspect called hygiene in those women which is called a sexual hygiene, a term probably coined by us or me. It looks like that we need to look at these women who are sexually active at night with coitus, not going to sleep without having maintained hygiene and without having gone to probably pass urine. If they have done that, they have flushed the urinary passage of the bacteria which may have gone inside. They have actually washed their introitus and probably prevented a situation which could be a morning wake-up alarm with acute dysuria and situations. Prophylaxis in all at-risk patients, antibiotic prophylaxis regimes, we all follow our own ways. Supportive therapies like cranberry and D-mannose combinations up to 2 grams daily, and complicating factors to be identified in time to involve your urologists and your centers, and therefore create a team where we is stronger than I. The journey of UTI from acute UTI to a recurrent UTI to urosepsis will always be a jigsaw puzzle to all clinicians. It's only that we could do a great teamwork, identify things early, and that is the truth of the moment that we need to take forward to. I always salute everybody who sits in the audience and takes these kind of combination monologues and discussions around, because behind every successful man is a woman, behind every successful urologist sitting in front of you, there are many gynecologists who made it happen. Behind every successful recurrent UTI program is every clinician in the audience who is sitting pan country in India today and listening to this, who understand the safety of teamwork, understand the safety of this kind of a therapy approach we need prob, and is motivated around. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming on this afternoon, looking at this subject again and probably revisiting the whole thing. I know it will always be a challenge and a dream to abolish recurrent UTI, like diseases to be abolished. But I think we will all work hard together, and with the kind of supportive therapy we get from some of the pharmaceutical companies, I think we're able to probably take the challenge to a different level. Thank you so much again. So I can see some questions coming. I don't know the locations from where they are, but the other questions around. One of them is, what is the use of, I would not name them the molecules here, but cranberry tablets. What is the use of cranberry tablets? Was discussed on slide number 37, 38, 39. Cranberry has a supportive role in preventing recurrent UTIs. What does it do? It actually has that effective way of paralyzing or looking at the fimbria. The fimbria are those which are the adhesive molecules to the uroepithelium. So if you heard me before the presentation, that we are in many ways trying to prevent the bacteria from growing and forming colony forming units. One of them is to look forward to not having this bacteria in large numbers of 10 to the power 5. So once a E. coli has walked in and the urinary tract, it is very important for us to look at not allowing its growth and going to high colony forming susceptible units. So whatever the name of the molecule of cranberry that you would be writing around, cranberry plus D-mannose will be effective in looking at the bacterial colony count doesn't rise. The bacteria, most commonly 80% of time, the E. coli would not be in a position to replicate itself because it cannot attach with the fimbriae to the uroepithelium. As a result of that, it will not be able to grow and form those colony forming units. So that's the first question from Chetna Arora. Sarita is asking a question about safe antibiotic during pregnancy in UTI. I'm sure gynecologists do a better job on this, so I'll be not in a situation to answer about the safe practices, but we all know at least that when a gynecologist calls us and say it's a UTI and are you intervening, we look at ampicillin as one of the drugs which we have. We not look at fluoroquinolones ever. Ampicillin group has still been, but in a complicated UTI and ascending UTI with pyelonephritis, we would look at the patient first. We would look at the mother first, the child little later. And we look at saving the mother. So if there's an UTI which is complicating, we'll go from the clinical situation, possibly go ahead and give an injectable antibiotics. Wish and pray nobody lands with sepsis, else carbapenems will be something which will think hard, hit fast, take the sepsis under control. So effective antibiotics, safe antibiotics are ampicillin group, the group that is normally used by gynecologists, something which you also would use, Sarita. Dr. Pratima Anand, does these nutraceutical ingredients are only sufficient to treat a recurrent UTI? In the Western world before cranberry and D-mannose and all which came into India, they were being used as empirical therapies to prevent UTIs, postcoital UTIs, women used to use them. So I understand now that these nutraceutical ingredients are extremely helpful as one arm. One arm is a safe hygienic sexual practices by that woman. Other arm is antibiotic prophylaxis, which could be a long term or a postcoital. Another strong arm from the west or the south could be a nutraceutical, which could be one of these or a combination of them. So you are using to kill your enemy from east, west, north and south. So why not use that? Because the recurrent UTI can go in multiple directions. We want it to be controlled in the time. There is a discussion on recurrent UTI in pregnancy, and I understand that's quite a challenge. Recurrent UTI in pregnancy is something where we need to look into. There is a lot of physiological change happening in the woman. when she is in those months of pregnancy. There's a lot of hormonal changes, physiological changes, anatomical changes too. There is that hydrouterine nephrosis developing. A lot of it is probably a little atonic ureters. A lot of it is related to the hormones. And somewhere down the line, the emptying mechanism may be lesser. These changes suppresses the patients around, and possibly the UTIs could be more ascending now, which were still localized to the lower tract. These women can land up with pyelonephritis. So any UTI in pregnancy has to be treated completely. You cannot let this go beyond that level. So if you pick up a symptomatic UTI in pregnancy, you will have to look at it, because recurrent UTIs have a cause. But this is one of the multiples that we produced, which is lying with me. Possibly an email could let you have a PDF format of that. This booklet, which talks a lot about various kinds of diagnosis and complications and early treatment on pregnancy and UTI. So your question, you know, Dr. Veda, is about recurrent UTI in pregnancy. I'll have to cut short that question in terms of preventing UTI, but treating UTI in pregnancy first, because UTI in pregnancy can be a disaster. Double wants to ask about D mannose 2 grams daily. Okay, wonderful question. Now, D mannose has to be given in a proper dose. Everything needs a dose. Even my lunch and breakfast has to be a proper dose. So when you look at a proper dosing, it is important that we look into the dosage that should reach the environment. Here, the reaching the environment is the bladder. They have been randomized clinical trials, which was published 2 years ago in the World Journal of Urology. You are privy to it, or I could send you the article online once you send me a mail. Is that this article talks about the randomized clinical trial and a lot of work on what dose was finally taken as an effective dose to be able to reach that location where we would be effectively able to treat. So a dose therapeutic relationship was established. Therefore, 2 grams daily as a sachet form, as a tablet form, or whatever forms available across the country will be the proper dose to reach the bladder, be able to effectively work at that FIMH adhesin molecule to bring about the demethylation and change in the receptor activity, because the fimbriae cannot attach. Okay, fine. Charanjit, there's a question from you. What's the preferred long-term antibiotic and what dosage? Well, that's good. I did not elaborate the long-term antibiotic here. But then again, there are various kinds of long-term antibiotic dosages which are practiced. Let me just go to a little bit of the Cochrane review on that. There was a talk of P-fluoxacin as one of the antibiotics given for at least 6 months. It worked wonders for women for 6 months. Stopping it or de-escalating it brought about changes in them. So we need to look into the antibiotic regimens depending on the community resistance patterns. So wherever you practice, in whichever situation you practice, there are these local infection committees in institutes, hospitals where we work in. We look forward to picking up the resistance patterns around. For example, if the common resistance pattern is of the lowest antibiotic, then we are in trouble. The world practices the lowest antibiotics. The best antibiotic to start with could be trimethoprim alone. Trimethoprim plus sulfamethoxazole has been a great combination for decades along. This has been a night dose or a prophylactic dose, not the full dose. Nitrofurantoin, to all of us, is a good antibiotic, antiseptic kind of phenomena, which works on a prophylactic dose and takes care of more of a luminal bacteria rather than, I would say, an inflammatory aspect of an organ. So if you have a prostatitis, if you have pyelonephritis, maybe nitrofurantoin could be a worthless drug. But if you have an acute uncomplicated UTI or recurrent UTI in a woman who doesn't have any obstructive nature, I think you would possibly use a nighttime dose of nitrofurantoin. Look at initially treating with that drug if you have a symptomatic patient with that drug, and then you probably go to the next drug. Fluoroquinolones are probably good stay of choice in the acute setup or in close recurrence setups, and then probably de-escalating it to smaller doses. The dosages that we use are sometimes not 500 milligram BD. They come to de-escalated to 250 milligram of ciprofloxacin, or 200 milligrams of P-fluoxacin, or 250 milligrams of levofloxacin. Well, you can't continue these drugs forever. So you will have to look at, therefore, decreasing the doses and using other aspects, and that's where cranberry and D-mannose could be highly effective in non-obstructed systems, in systems where there is no complicating factors. So the dosages is a lot decided by the local resistance patterns, the community patterns, the antibiotic focus channels which your institute has, and obviously the changes which is seen. You will have to do cultures to look at symptomatic patients and take them forwards. Role of probiotics in recurrent UTI. Well, you are attempting to use at this point in time antibiotics. You're attempting to use nutraceuticals which have got direct focus effect. I'm not very sure if there could be that kind of a work still done on probiotics, which could add another arm to our treatment. But I wish and look forward to this question answering you in due course of time, whether we will be able to take that forward. Okay, there's a question about is cranberry and D-mannose safe in cases of CRF? Yes, it has been proven already that cranberry and D-mannose are safe therapies in CRF. These are available directly into the urinary passage without a gross metabolic change happening, and as a result of which their effectiveness is in the urinary tract, not somewhere in the kidneys, not somewhere in any systemic phenomena. We got to look forward to them reaching the urinary passage, the urinary environment in the best of the dosages around. So I think they have been quite safe in articles talked about. I would like to continue these in patients. I look forward to what else can we do in CRF cases. CRF cases could have other reasons of possibly, you know, being looked into for UTI. Some CRF could be possibly an obstruction had gone in. So I think multiple issues to be looked into. Dr. Sushila Jain, thank you for this question. Choice of antibiotic in chronic indwelling catheter. There are 50,000 patients in this city where I live and work, and many more across the country who live on catheter. Either it could be a periurethral catheter, which I prefer not in long-term catheterized patients, or suprapubic catheter. And we prefer not anybody on antibiotic pills. So don't give your patients antibiotics because they are on catheter. Any foreign body, it could be a stent, it could be a stone, it could be a catheter, will get colonized in 3 days with bacteria out there, like bacteria sitting in the intestines, in the nasal cavity, in the vagina. Bacteria will be sitting there. Unless they become enemies, there's no point killing them. Because who knows, the next enemy that you probably think about, the bacteria which will come after killing this set of bacteria, could possibly be enemies. So all indwelling catheterized patients may not require antibiotics. These patients live on catheters and live forever. There are patients who catheterize themselves with self-catheterization 4 times a day, and these patients don't never need an antibiotic. So antibiotic has a role, antibiotic has a requirement. Prophylaxis is required to prevent a UTI. All patients who are on catheter, not necessarily develop a UTI. There could be an immunosuppressed patient, there could be a patient whose catheter is blocked, there could be a patient who lands up in a UTI, not on the urinary passage, but accessory sexual passage like prostate, developing a prostatitis and a prostatic abscess, epidema or catheter resulting as a result of a catheter to the urinary tract. So that's where a chronic indwelling catheter will have to make a change. So from this platform, I would like to request, if a patient is going to be a long-term catheter, please convert him or her from a periurethral catheter to a suprapubic cystostomy. That actually takes away your burden of treating a recurrent UTI in this patient, because you are bypassing the introitus and the urethra and the vagina. You are bypassing the two-way ticket of the bacteria moving from the external matrix, the vagina, into the bladder. Therefore, that could probably be escaped. Same thing would happen to men, and they would develop less of orchitis, less of urethritis, less of prostatitis, because it is a suprapubic cystostomy, and many of these may not get UTIs. So long-term catheters have to be taken into conclusion as to why they need it. If they need it, possibly change. Dr. Saroj Srivastava, very nice presentation. Please throw light on prevalence of chlamydia infection causing UTI, how to document it and how to treat it. Okay, we are into a different aspect altogether. You could mail me on this. I would send you some of the presentations I made. Now, this is a bacteria basically in sexually active young men. It also does cause a similar problem in men, basically urethritis, with that liquid secretion, not the thick secretion of gonococcus, is something which wakes us up, and probably we would use tetracycline group of drugs to probably neutralize this very early in their documentation is again by microorganism cultures and by swabs around, something which is out of domain of today's practice. But yes, these are not so common. More common are the bacteria, and something where we need to look into. Okay, what are the urinary complications of enteric fever? Enteric fever is a systemic phenomenon, and probably people could develop complications in the GI tract. More commonly, the urinary tract could land up patients who possibly are catheterized or immobile. Okay. So there's a good question from Paramjeet. Should every patient with urinary tract symptoms be advised culture sensitivity first time? Not necessarily. You have an acute, uncomplicated cystitis happening in a woman for the second time. She could probably be in a resort or in a holiday. She may not require something like a culture sensitivity around. I mean, the rule is you give a urine sample first for routine and culture, and then go ahead with antibiotic therapy, which is a full dose therapy. You go ahead with a fluoroquinolone twice daily. You give a supportive therapy for a dysuria, burning sensation, frequency, urgency, etc. But so you are acutely treating a patient. An acute uncomplicated cystitis is a self-resolving illness, unless possibly we are not able to support it and it goes further. So a 1 to 3 days therapy of newer antibiotics, of antibiotics which could take one session and clear it up, like fosfomycin, all this could be possibly happening. So every patient with urinary symptoms does not require a culture sensitivity. Urinary symptoms can be of multiple kinds. Every dysuria, every burning sensation is not a UTI. We need to look into that. Which antibiotic should you use for long-term UTI prophylaxis? I've already answered. UTI prophylaxis is something which is tailored to the needs of the patient, tailored to the requirements of the patient, the local committees, the antibiotic and the community resistance patterns, and obviously look at the kind of patient we're dealing with. Somebody with a CRF can take this and not that antibiotic. Somebody may not be able to tolerate an antibiotic. And are there ways to possibly prevent a long-term prophylaxis? So we need to look into all that aspects around. Good questions around. Are you have any more questions? Okay. There's one question which I can see coming in is, what do you advise your patients with recurrent UTI? Okay. So if somebody has come to me with a recurrent UTI and possibly wants to know what will I do, which so many clinicians have done in the past, then I will have to look into a few aspects. One is communicate more with the patient first. Talk to the patient and tell them that this could possibly be your end of agony. I know it will not be the end of the agony, but give them the confidence to get into a therapy which could be more investigations, more diagnosis and possibly more treatments. The patient has already lost out with 3 or 5 UTIs. Some of this could actually have required a different kind of therapy. So when you're looking at that, we would talk to them and know what are those incrementing factors which bring about recurrence. And when I look at these young women, we look at obviously talking about sexual hygiene, looking at those practices around. The scare that a lot of women have is that when we go to a public washroom, we'll get infected. But that's not true. You already have friendly neighborhood in terms of vagina and rectum, which actually have bacteria waiting to infect a urinary tract, which has got no bacteria. So why are you worried about a bacteria sitting deep down 75 centimeters below in the washroom commode? So it's not that a bacteria jumps up from the commode and enters the urinary passage, but it's about that area called the introitus, where there's a urethra in the opening in the front, the vagina behind and the rectum there. All these three locations are actually in such a situation, they all open together. Now the friendly neighborhood of the urethra are this vagina and this rectum, and they actually can be troublesome because bacteria wandering out from these locations can be a trouble. They are the ones which need to be looking at. So therefore, sexual hygiene is something which is a very important kind of a mechanism we need to look into. Sexual hygiene is to be practiced at night when you had a sexual activity or coitus, and the next day morning when you wake up you have got acute dysuria and all those issues. So I think it is important for the patient to agree to some therapies which may not have happened, and the therapies which you enlisted is treat the acute setup immediately, look at the causes in history, look at a uroflowmetry. We didn't discuss that. A young man or young woman coming in may not have a great flow, possibly, and you and I have never questioned that. We are still busy about urine routines and cultures. So we look forward to a symptomatic patient having multiple cultures and multiple therapies done, change of antibiotics, having resistance patterns by now. And when you land up in a situation where you have a patient who doesn't know what is a uroflowmetry or doesn't believe possibly that the flow can be bad, take those investigations which could be missing. So colleagues in urology would do a thorough questioning on the urinary aspects, look at the sexual hygiene part, look at what is a uroflow pattern, and many a times it may not be a bell-shaped pattern that you and I have. It could be a flat flow. Patient could have adjusted to something in long term. So we look at the larger aspect of these and probably get these patients moving. So once to build up a confidence, treat their acute setup this time, look at the factors which have been missed, and then go into therapies. Those therapies which are required, which I have enlisted, are extremely effective unless you have got a complicating factor. So as a urologist, I'll search for complicating factors if there could be any. I would focus my treatment into the nutraceuticals which could be effective where I can't reach, the antibiotic prophylaxis after the therapeutic dose, and then possibly follow the patient. Probably get the patient back to somebody who's treating the patient and probably keep in tandem. So these are the patients who have to come out of this. You need to abolish recurrent UTI in one patient and then go to the next patient. There's a question about what is your take on fosfomycin single dose. Fosfomycin is an effective antibiotic. Being newer into therapies right now doesn't have that kind of antibiotic resistance pattern. One single dose is enough for you to treat an acute uncomplicated lower tract UTI or uncomplicated cystitis. Yes, so it's available as a sachet form, and a lot of people have actually gone overboard and treated these patients who got recurrent UTIs or aggressive lower tract UTI with a little longer dosages around. But one single dose of fosfomycin is an effective treatment for acute uncomplicated cystitis. That's how it should be taken forward to. Patients need to be kept into the paradigm of understanding that this is happening because of your body. This is happening something where we can do this much, you got to do the rest of it. So it's more of a teamwork also between doctor and the patient. It has to be taken to those levels around. Thank you so much. Thank you, Nutriva, and thank you all for having come on this presentation schedule today. We look forward to anybody who would like to have this book or other focused attempts to take it forward to the next level. Thank you, everybody.